Welcome to worship with Grace Lutheran Church here on this seventh Sunday of Easter. We are so glad that you could join us today, whether you are listening on KTOE Radio or watching through one of our various digital means. If you want to learn more about Grace or get connected with us, you can join us on Facebook at Grace Mankato ELCA or check out our website, gracemankato.org. Our worship continues today with a confession and assurance of forgiveness. We confess our sins before God and one another. Risen Lord, we see the miracle of your resurrection, yet so often live as though we are still lost in our sins. We rely on our own feeble will. We remain mired in the past, and we refuse that which is too uncomfortable or unfamiliar. Forgive us and open our hearts again to your freedom. Amen. Praise God. Christ is arisen. We have a new life and the old has fallen away. Rejoice that you are truly forgiven. And go out and proclaim the grace that is free to all in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise to God who raises the dead. Death has been defeated. Bringing Jesus back to life, death has been defeated. Where's the sting of dying? Death has been defeated.
Thank you.
the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you always. Let us pray. O Christ, you have indeed been raised from the dead. Therefore, let us live as though death no longer holds us hostage, putting our hope in the one who goes before us, both in death and in eternal life, our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. In our lesson from the narrative lectionary this week, Paul expressed the promise that Jesus' death would not have the final say. Sin and death would be defeated by love. And then in our reading chosen by Bishop Hassanali, Jesus teaches us what that love looks like when we live it out in our daily lives. Reading from the narrative lectionary for today comes from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 15, verses 12 through 26 and 54 through 57. Now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our proclamation has been in vain, and your faith has been in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God because we testified of God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised, and if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have died in Christ have perished. If for this life only we have hoped in Christ, we are, of all people, to be most pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have died. For since death came through a human being, the resurrection of the dead has also come through a human being. For all of us die in Adam, so all of us will be made alive in Christ, but each in his own order, Christ the first fruits. And then at his coming, those who belong to Christ, and then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father, after he has destroyed every ruler and authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. When this perishable body puts on imperishability, and this mortal body puts on immortality, then the saying that is written will be fulfilled. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now we will hear a children's message from Ben, our director for spiritual growth.
Morning, kids. I'm here in the chapel at church today, and I want to sing a song with you all. It's a new song, so I'll sing it now, and then we'll all sing it together in a little bit. It's called To Be Alive.
To be alive, to live the love that is alive, in God's saving Son who brought us back from the life of death, to be alive. There is nothing I can do to save me. Only God carries us home. So we live mercy, hope, and freedom, loving another to be whole. To be alive is to live the love that is alive. And God's saving Son who brought us back from the life of death, to be alive. Join the singing, join the celebration. Jesus lives, we are restored. Love alive, giving and forgiving, loving another to be whole. To be alive is to live the love that is alive. In God's saving Son who brought us back from the life of death, to be alive.
So I like that song. I like in the chorus where it says, to be alive is to live the love that is alive in God's saving Son, who brought us back from the life of death, to be alive. It makes me think about, even though Jesus came to earth and died a very real death on the cross, he's still alive. In the reading today, Paul writes to the Corinthians and tells them about the death of Jesus. But he also tells them about the resurrection of Jesus. That resurrection is some good news. Jesus died, but rose again. Jesus lives in us. We need to love the way Jesus loved us. We talked last week about, if we all love, we will not be like when my fingers are on the wrong spots on the guitar, making awful noise. But it's when my fingers are on the right spots, and it can make something beautiful. So as I'm here in the chapel at the church, I look up and I see the cross on the wall. I see the cross as not a reminder of the death of Jesus, but a reminder of God's love and how Jesus conquered death and is still alive in us. So let's sing that song again, To Be Alive. And I'll have the words on the screen, and you can all sing along.
To be alive, to live the love that is alive, in God's saving Son who brought us back from the life of death, to be alive. There is nothing I can do to save me, only love that is alive in God's saving Son who brought us back from the life of death to be alive. Join the singing, join the celebration. Jesus lives, we are restored. Love alive, giving and forgiving, loving another too. Behold, to be alive is to live the love that is alive in God's saving Son who brought us back from the life of death to be alive.
So that's the song, To Be Alive. I hope you enjoyed it. I've enjoyed singing the song with you all. So now, please pray with me. And kids, you can repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for loving us. You came to earth and died on the cross, but you're still alive in us. We love you. Amen.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of men, you were here before the world began. Above all thought of me.
second reading, chosen for today, is from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 14 through 27. Indeed, the body of Christ does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot were to say, "Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body," that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear were to say, "Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body," that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body so that each one of them is as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, "I have no need of you," nor again the head to the feet, "I have no need of you." On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with the greater honor. And our less respectable members are treated with greater respect. Whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now you are the body of Christ, and individually members of it. And now I turn over the pulpit to our Bishop Regina Hassanelli for the gospel reading and for the message today.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 10th chapter. Just then, a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" He answered to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this, and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." Of the human tendency to make gods of ourselves, Martin Luther said, "This is the greatest idolatry that we have practiced up until now, and it is still rampant in the world. It involves only that conscience that seeks help, comfort, and salvation in its own works and presumes to wrest heaven from God." Presumes to wrest heaven from God. If there is ever a time in which we might be tempted to wrest heaven from God, it is perhaps in times that to our mortal minds make the least sense. Times of anxiety, uncertainty, and stress. Times in which the temptation to become gods ourselves can be great. In which we are tempted to upend the good order of things and create a system in which we are each uniquely and individually at the center of it all. I see this temptation in social media fights about who is wrong and who is right on any particular matter. I see it in the desire to appease one person or another over and above the sake of all others. I see it in the proclamations we are so tempted to make to prove to everyone else at any cost that we alone know the right, good, and prudent thing to do. This temptation to make ourselves, as Luther said, the ones who hold all good. And this very temptation to make ourselves God is the one to which the first commandment speaks. The Israelites are in the wilderness when the commandments come. God speaks through Moses and uses the wilderness wanderings to help shape and reform the people into a new identity, a new way of being and living in community as they prepare to enter the promised land. And the first commandment God speaks is, "You shall have no other gods." Perhaps because it is so often the hardest. We are often fooled into thinking if we don't overtly worship anything other than the one true God, then idolatry is not our vice. But it would be better, perhaps, instead to be aware of how tempting it actually is to worship other things, including ourselves. And so when God is forming a people and giving them a new communal identity, the first thing God says is this: "I am the center of all things, not you." And it is, of course, so tempting to make ourselves, each of us as individuals, the most important person in the community, to make our desires or needs or wants the ones that should matter most. And to this temptation, God sets us aright by reminding us, commanding us, that there is only one God, and none of us is it. So this becomes the orientation of our way of life together. A community of people in which God alone is God and God is at our center. And we hear this again in the words of Jesus when asked in the Gospel of Matthew, "Teacher, what is the greatest commandment?" And Jesus responds, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself." For those of us who have studied the commandments in catechism class, we know that all 10 of them hang on these two central ideas, to love God and to love others. And we know that that first group of commandments teaches us what it means to love God, and that that second group helps us understand what it means to love people. We know that it can all be summed up in the words of Jesus, that we are to love God and love our neighbors as ourselves. So we start here, with this orientation of a community built around love of God. And from this center, we move toward love of other. Because we are loved by and love God, God's love pours out through us and toward our neighbors as well. But what does this neighborly love look like when it's rooted in love of God and God's love for us? It's a fair question. And one we hear asked in this morning's gospel reading. After hearing the words of Jesus that he's to love God and love his neighbor, a smart man asks for clarity. "Who's my neighbor?" he wants to know. Jesus responds not with a technical or clinical definition, but a story. A story that answers the question, "Who's my neighbor?" and shows us what it looks like to love someone else. The story is, of course, a familiar one. That of the Good Samaritan, who after seeing a man beaten and left for dead on the side of the road, is the only one to stop, tend the man, pick him up and carry him somewhere safe, all the while ensuring his needs are met for the duration of his duress. The neighbor, the smart man realizes, is the one who treated the other with mercy. The neighbor is the one who, even upon his own inconvenience, ensured another person's needs were met. The neighbor is the one whose love of God compelled him to acts of love toward another. And upon his realization, Jesus looks at that smart man and says, "Go and do likewise. Go, love your neighbor, rooted in your love of God and God's love for you. Show mercy upon mercy to those you meet." It is a radical definition of neighbor, for many reasons, and I'm sure you've heard plenty of them before. But those reasons include the fact that the Samaritan had no reason to help, and in fact had plenty of reason not to. Those reasons include the fact that it surely took the Samaritan more time and effort, and it is quite clear, added expense to care for the beaten man on the side of the road. And that Samaritan did it anyway. This is the story Jesus tells to teach us what love of neighbor means. And it's a powerful one at that. There's one more way of loving neighbor I want to explore with you. And that is through the words of Paul in his letter to the Corinthians about their identity as the body of Christ. We know that we too are part of this body, followers of Jesus and bound together by the Spirit. We are parts of communities of faith, the body of Christ. And we can tell by the letters that we read that the people of God in Corinth were familiar with some strife, and so their teacher, their pastor, often from afar, wrote letters of instruction. And our reading from 1 Corinthians comes from this place. And in it, Paul teaches the church at Corinth what it means to be the body of Christ. Paul writes this: "As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, 'I have no need of you,' nor again the head to the feet, 'I have no need of you.' But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it." This is, I think, a particularly helpful passage to keep in mind in these pandemic days. It reminds us as we move forward with new ways to worship and we explore possibilities for gathering in the future that we are bound together, and that as the body of Christ, there is no single part of the body that can be regarded without love, compassion, honor, and care. It's one more lens through which we understand the greatest commandments: to love God and love neighbor. And it's a guardrail on the way as we may be tempted to consider the needs or abilities of one group over another. In all three of our readings this morning, we hear an identity-defining way of living in faith together, that we as the people of God and followers of Jesus keep love of God at the center of our communal life, and that rooted in this love we are, through the work of the Spirit, able to love others, even when it feels an inconvenience, even when it requires self-sacrifice, even when it costs us something. We know, all the way back to our beginnings in hearing the words of God teaching us how to live, and through the gospel admonition to go and do likewise, and the teaching of Paul to the early church, we know that we, as followers of Jesus, do not prize our individual welfare over and above that of our neighbor. We do not value our personal conveniences and enjoyments over and above the safekeeping of other members of the body. Instead, because of the lavish love of God poured out on us, we are free to live for the sake and good of those around us, not because we are gods, but because we are not, because we are so rooted in the abundant love of God and life through Jesus Christ that we too are vessels for this love for the sake of the world. Dear church, remember who you are: a people centered and rooted in God's perfect love, and from this place sent forth to love the world. And in loving that world, we choose to care for the neighbor, the one in the grocery store aisles and the ones we would normally be seated next to in a Sunday morning pew. Remember that we are bound together in the body of Christ, each of us needed, each of us loved, each of us caring for and being loved by all others. These have been difficult and sometimes lonely days, but we are not alone. We are the people of God, formed and shaped by God's good love for the sake of the world. May the Spirit of God fill you up to overflowing, so that you may be emboldened to love God and love neighbor in radically Christ-like ways. In the name of Jesus, amen.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me because you died. You were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be? I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. Now it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. You are my King. Jesus, you are my King. Jesus, you are my King.
Amazing love,
how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love. In all I do, I honor you. In all I do, I honor you. In all I do, let me honor you.
Now, with the whole church, let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now we pray for the church, the world, and for all those in need. It seems too good to be true. But you have conquered death, O Lord, and removed its sting. May this truth give us hope, courage, and freedom to live boldly as your disciples. As one thing dies, another is born. This cycle of death and rebirth is imprinted into all of your creation. Teach us to let go of what wants to pass on, so that we might embrace what is waiting to emerge. As another academic year draws to a close, and as we pause to acknowledge the successes and disappointments of this past year, we give you thanks for all of the opportunities you have given us to grow, especially in those very unexpected ways. May we take what is good and bring it forward into our future and learn from our past mistakes. Our suffering in this life is but the blink of an eye compared with the eternal peace which awaits us. When trials overshadow us, give us perspective and hope for wholeness perfected in you. Today we offer prayers especially for Pete, Bill, LaDonna, Randall, Lauren, Margaret, Renee, Dick, Vi, Robin, David, Andrew, and the family and friends of Tom. We also lift up before you, Lord, those names that we hold in our hearts now. We celebrate the lives of Nicholas Copernicus and Leonard Euler and give thanks for the scientists in our midst who study your world and try to make order of it. May we use their discoveries to improve ourselves, our lives, and the way we care for one another and our planet. Risen Lord, you give us hope in all things, and we entrust our prayers to your grace, knowing that you have heard us. In Jesus' name, amen. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all, and I invite you to share a sign of peace with those near you and to reach out and offer a word of peace to someone who you are not able to be with today. Send them a text message. Send them a message on Facebook, whatever you can, to let them know that you are thinking of them, they are not alone, and that they are a part of this body of Christ wherever they are. And while we continue to worship from a distance for the well-being of our neighbors, we are grateful for the ways that you have continued to support the mission and ministry of Grace Lutheran Church. You can make a gift today by going to our website, gracemankato.org. And right on our homepage, you'll find a link to give electronically, or you can send us a text message right now to support Grace. You can text any amount, like the number 2020, to the phone number 507-607-7337, and they're going to send you instructions to set up a one-time gift. It's really fast and easy. Again, that number is 507-607-7337. Because of your generosity and your commitment to the work that Jesus has set before us, we continue to proclaim that all are welcome in God's kingdom. We continue to serve our neighbors through various outreach avenues and through our community garden, through supporting local causes, and by growing in new and creative ways through this opportunity. And we are still going to be here when this is over, as a place where God's children come together to live and work to serve others. Thank you.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made,
that the Lord has made.
We will rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it,
and be glad in it.
This is the day that the Lord has made, we will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made.
Because you live, O Lord, we know the joy of your kingdom of life. Bless these gifts that we bring out of our gratitude for your salvation and as fuel for your great mission on earth. For Jesus' sake, amen. During times of change, many of us seek a moment of familiar reassurance. And for us who are used to celebrating Holy Communion together, this is one reminder of the truth that no matter what changes in this world, Jesus Christ has promised to be with us. The Gospel of John tells us, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him. And without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being through him was life, and this life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. And rather than focus on what we do not have, we are invited in this time to find the familiar and comforting presence of the Word in more than just bread and wine. The Word comes to us whenever the gospel is proclaimed in our hearing. The Word is present in the Scriptures as we read and learn to love God. We have the promised presence of the Word in our baptism, in which we are marked with the cross of Christ forever. The Word lives in the Church of Christ in every age, and whenever two or more are gathered in the name of Jesus, there is the Word. And so today, though we are unable to share this meal, I invite you to hear these words and to remember, there is nothing that can separate you from the love of God. Christ is with you now and forever. Hear now how on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup. And after giving thanks, he gave it, saying, "Take and drink. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it for the remembrance of me." And so remembering, we pray as our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray. By your grace, O Lord, we are what we are, and for this we give thanks. We come before you exactly as you have created us, living in the light of your love, so that our lives might then serve as witness to others. Give us the certain hope of your promised presence, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.